So I guess I'm introducing myself. I'm Lloyd Williams. I'm one of the second-year residents, and I'm going to try to go through this relatively quickly so that there's time for discussion. This patient was not presented. It seems there was some confusion. We were unable to even get an adequate exam in the pediatrics clinic, so it wasn't felt like it would be possible to bring him in and for any of you to get an adequate exam with so many people. He was previously presented by one of the medical students, but since then, more information has been acquired, and also a lot of people were away at Academy. So Dr. Gries is hoping that people can offer some suggestions. This is a four-year-old male who presented very light sensitive in his left eye, had a red eye, a lot of eye rubbing, squinting, perhaps some clumsiness and some changes in performance. He'd had an eye exam greater than a year ago where the findings that I'm going to show you were not seen. He has a past medical history of hydrocephalus and a past ocular history of congenital iris and retinal coloboma with microophthalmia in the left eye, otherwise an unremarkable history. We were unable to get a good visual acuity. He doesn't cooperate with the exam. He has some evidence of a cleft lip, hypertelorism, and a small eye on the left, so we scheduled an EUA. On the EUA, his pressures were normal, and a vascularized mass was found in the anterior chamber with a hyphema. There was no view of the iris or lens and no view of the posterior chamber. And at that time, our differential diagnosis included retinoblastoma, persistent fetal vasculature, medulloepithelioma, uveitis, toxocara, and trauma. 2 weeks later, a repeat EUA was done. The hyphema and anterior chamber mass were still present, and there was still no view of the fundus in the left eye. The exam of the right eye was basically normal. And the patient was referred to the Shields' at Will's Eye. Laboratory tests were also done. Toxocara was negative. ESR was 1. Chem-8 and CBC were roughly normal except for a low hematocrit. HSV IgG was negative. I'm not sure what the significance of a positive IgM in this particular patient is. So they were evaluated at Will's Eye by Jerry and Carol Shields, who did not think that the patient had retinoblastoma or medulloepithelioma, and that their thought was that this was most likely a lateral persistent fetal vasculature, and they suggested serial ultrasounds and enucleation if the eye became painful. During one of the EUAs, we also did an ERG, which was flat. So it's our thought is that this eye has very little visual potential. Sorry about the typo here. If it is medulloepithelioma, the Shields thought that it would be possible to follow it without risk of extraocular extension. And so their differential diagnosis, although they thought medulloepithelioma is less likely, their differential diagnosis included persistent fetal vascular and medulloepithelioma. They thought that this eye was likely headed for glaucoma, had a poor visual prognosis, that a fine needle or open corneal biopsy might be possible, and they thought if this were done, enucleation would also be a reasonable follow within roughly a week of biopsy. We did another EUA now 5 weeks after presentation, after the patient returned from Will's, and found still a normal IOP with a new sheet of yellow-white tissue across the pupil. The mass was still there. The hyphema or mass may be enlarging. It was difficult to tell. And I'll show you some pictures in just a little bit, whether or not this is an increased size of the mass or a consolidation of the hyphema. Still no view of the iris or lens or posterior pole. I'll show you also ultrasound and MRI, but a brief summary of them is that there was no unequivocal calcium. The eye is in fact small with a flat AC and a hypervascular AC. Posteriorly, there may be a persistent hyoid artery. So here's a, I'll just go through four pictures which are pretty similar of the anterior chamber. This is from November 10th. This is November 8th. I'll go through them in this order. So this is October 25th. You can see this mass. This is, these vessels are deep to the cornea in the anterior chamber, not on the cornea. This is, I'm sorry, I don't have the right order here. This is the first picture, 10-8. This is the second picture, 10-25. So that's the difference there. And this is the third picture, 11-10.
Hey boy.
Yep.
Sorry, so the mass is superior and it's kind of sitting on top of the iris, is that?
That's correct. It's anterior to the iris, posterior to the cornea.
And you might want to point out there are really two masses there. There's a mass, the left and the mass, so about 5 o'clock.
Right here.
They're very similar in appearance.
And in particular, it's difficult to see whether or not this one is in fact growing or if you're just seeing more of it because the hyphema is changing. This one appears to be growing as well, although that could also be consolidation of the hyphema, just showing you more of the mass that was already present. And so then this is the most recent photograph, whereas you can see that this is in fact more prominent than it was in this image down here. So the ultrasound, these are from Dr. Harry. This arrow represents the lens, and this represents a peripheral vitreous membrane. And a tuft visible on the optic disc. Flat AC and mass up here. Elongated ciliary processes. And vitreous membrane with fibrous material on the optic disc. And thickened cornea in the area of the mass, and perhaps a fibrovascular membrane along the endothelial surface. This is a CT scan, which doesn't show any clear calcium here in the left eye, which is smaller. This is a T1 non-contrast image where you see thickening here, or membrane. Here's a T1 fat sat. You see the mass here, and here's a T1 fat sat post contrast. Does anybody want to see any of those images again?
So can you see the hyoid artery on the scan? It would look like a membrane.
Couldn't that be a hyoid artery that would look like a vitreous membrane already? In your ultrasound?
Yeah, I'm certainly differential. I was trying to make a case for PADPV, just with the solar processes and stuff on the
right.
Optic disc, so I think it's not leading in that direction.
But the serial, what's fascinating is Dr. Underball in Arizona. He saw this game. Said Michael Young had a virus acquired by the polyploma that could be quite obvious.
So he didn't see anything abnormal other than the pre-existing small eye with polyploma.
Yeah, Dr. Underball.
Okay.
So that is the remarkable. That seems a lot. My thought would be there's a retinal compaction in the polyploma, but perhaps excavated distal canal. So
just along the edge of the coloboma, very common to develop retinal detachments, retinitis detachments along the edge of the arterial coloboma, the coloboma syndrome. No. So this has to bring it up. So Dave, do you think that we're seeing clearing of pyedema or progression of mass?
I think
so. I'm clear. I mean, because looking at the pictures, you can interpret it either way.
Right. And I think the masses are not enlarging.
Okay.
The masses that were seen in the first one.
Right. You got two masses. You got this one that you see over here to the left, and you've got this larger mass down
right.
in
and
that
those,
area.
Those are thick. Those are movies from over here that probably were like 2 millimeters thick. And then that yellowish of fibrous tissue that's marching across the anterior chamber, that's new.
Okay.
In the brain. And I think that's probably the foundation of the tumor. And that is this fibrous syndrome after a pulse trauma. You know, it'd be really nice to have a pretty good sense of the diagnosis before we do the biopsy and or reconstruction. So I'm just, you know, and the boy's perfectly happy right now. He's comfortable. Yeah. So we're not pushed.
Right.
You need him right away.
You've already had somebody that you trust look at it and give you advice to follow.
Yeah. So.
So I. The other thing I do is you're going to take the eye out, school level physiology, just to document
yeah.
the status of, you know, maybe vision potential or lack thereof, in case that becomes a question.
Right.
Yeah, that's been done, and that was.
You already
it
done
was
that. Okay.
Pretty
yeah,
flat.
I think we talked about that in the first.
Yeah, well, it was flat. So.
Yeah.
This is not the one of these. I have one case of this in all of 3 or 4 years. Mysterious process.
I had one like this that went to, again, the experts that came back saying it's not medial epithelioma, but that is exactly what the pathology showed
right.
when the eye came up.
I don't know that.
And so, you know, these are not easy cases.
Yeah. So, but anything. For anyone, how much time do you have to put for the extraocular extension? It's not known. Right?
It's not known. I mean, there are case reports. I've reviewed that literature. That case reports of local and distant spread of medulla epithelioma, they're rare. And most of the time, medulla epithelioma isn't the primary suspected diagnosis. Things are operated upon, and it's when there's progressive destruction of the eye that the diagnosis is uncovered.
So, but I think as long as on your vision study, if you don't see an extraocular extension, that's the largest time.
Me. I'd still be nervous. And if it were my child, I'd ask you a biopsy is, and if it looked like tumor, take it out and not fall.
Okay.
Well, Dave, you know, medulla